Blackstone Publishing presents Girl Gone Missing by Marcie R. Rendon. This book is read by Siiri Scott. Dedicated to Earl for the secondary PTSD experiences, and to Ray for knowing more about Nam and cars than me. Cash pulled herself up and out of her bedroom window. Her heart beat in her ears and she shivered uncontrollably. She took off running, barefoot, zigzagging across the damp ground. Her eyes darted left and right. She ran toward the plowed field in the direction that led to town. Her foot sank into the cold, wet dirt of the furrowed field. When she tried to pull her foot up, her front leg sank into the dirt even deeper. She threw herself forward, clawing at the mud with bare hands, hearing the heavy, labored breathing of the person chasing her. Fear forced her from her body so that she was soon flying above herself. She looked back to see who was chasing her, but all she could see was a body, the face obscured in the darkness. She looked down and could see herself stretched out in the mud below, buried to her knees, arms flailing. Some of her long brown hair was tangled up in her hands as she struggled to steady herself. But the body changed abruptly. No longer her struggling, not a short, dark-haired Indian girl, but a pale, tall, and bony blonde who looked up at Cash and screamed, "Help me!" On that sunny note, Cash crawled out of bed, got dressed, and headed from Fargo to the Moorhead State campus on the other side of the Red River Bridge. She nursed a tepid cup of coffee, intended to get her through her first two classes, while she tried to shake the dream from her head. With a one-hour break between her biology and psychology classes, Cash made a beeline for her ranchero and retrieved her cue stick from behind the front seat. She took off across campus to the student union, heading for the billiard room. It was beet hauling season in the valley, and Cash was driving beet truck afternoons and evenings when her class schedule allowed. Between classes, she would stop at the rec hall to practice her game. The rec hall allowed students 24-hour access to the larger tables and no fee to play with a student ID. Her game had improved considerably since starting college. Barroom pool tables tended to be shorter so as not to take up too much drinking space. But here at the rec hall, the full-size tables were always open. Apparently, Midwest farmer-type college students weren't pool sharks. They spent more time writing term papers and reading textbooks. Cash was learning a lot at Moorhead State College. She had already found out that most girls her age considered shooting pool a sin against their church upbringing. While Cash drank Budweiser and wore straight-legged blue jeans and a clean t-shirt under a Levi jean jacket each day, a good handful of the students preferred smoking weed to drinking. They dressed in bell-bottom jeans and sheer peasant blouses. Hippie attire. They talked about making love, not war. They flashed peace signs at each other as they crossed the green campus lawn. And then there were the college jocks, the students from small-town, conference-winning sports teams, who were big-shot scholarship jocks now. They were too undersized for any professional team they might hope to be scouted for. And who knew to look for them in the Red River Valley of the North anyway? There were also the studious kids, students who in their small towns had been picked on, teased, or ostracized because they got A's in algebra without cheating, who read Macbeth and enjoyed it. The ones who willingly stayed after school to create potions in the underfinanced science labs of the high schools, ruled by the captain of the football team and his cheerleader homecoming queen. Cash had always played eight ball for money, but here at college she had learned how to play nine ball against fraternity jocks who considered it the only pool game worthy of their time. It kept her in shape for the money-making games at the Casbah, her home bar over in Fargo, on the North Dakota side of the Red River. She removed her cue stick from the fringed leather case she had made a few years ago. She screwed the two lengths of stick together and rolled it across the green of the 9-foot table. She chalked the tip of her cue and broke the rack. She started with the one ball, then went ball by ball in numerical order, attempting a bank shot for each one into an opposite corner. She frustrated herself with her failures. She stretched her 5'2" frame over the pool table, her cue stick resting easily on the arch made between her thumb and curled pointer finger.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.